Good morning, church. It's so nice to greet you this morning online. It's quite sunny and bright, and I've got Rachel with me.
Good morning, Edwin, and good morning, everybody.
How are you, Rachel?
Yeah, I'm doing well. It's been a really exciting week. How are you going?
It has been very good to me as well. So could you tell me what brought joy to you this past week?
Yes, yeah, so on Freedom Day, the 11th, last Monday, we got to have Jared's family over for dinner, and that was so nice. It was really refreshing, like more so than I thought it was going to be.
Right.
And we sat there till, I think, 10 p.m. just laughing and, yeah, had a barbecue, and, yeah, it was really good. What about yourself? What brought joy to you this week?
Yeah, I think ministry-wise, my week started with a joyful note when Steve announced that we were going to meet last Sunday, that on the 31st of October, we were going to meet in person. And then I was since then following up the vaccination rates in Sydney. And yesterday we hit the 80% mark. So that was good. And we concluded the book review of Sam Chan's book, How to Talk About Jesus Without Being That Guy, on Friday. And that also brought me great joy. And personally, in the week, I didn't do much. But Joyce went out with her girlfriends and had lunch together on Friday. And but I'm looking forward to this Saturday, where 17 of us are going to meet. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
Wow, that's great.
And Rachel, what have you got planned now that we are reopening or regathering on the 31st of October? What have you got planned for the young people as well as for the kids?
Yeah, so for the kids, we're planning to have Kids Church start back up on the 31st as we all meet back together. So that will largely look the same as it did before, with creche and preschool meeting together. And then we'll have K-5 groups. And then we'll also have youth church, so 6-8. And then for the youth, we are going to meet for the first time in person on the 28th.
Wow.
And yeah, we're so excited. We're really looking forward to seeing them again. And we're going to have a bit of a welcome back party,
yep,
for all the ones who've been with us. But we're also going to be welcoming the New Year Sixes on the 28th as well. So that's exciting. And if you're a Year Six out there, we really look forward to having you join us on a Thursday.
I'm pretty sure it's going to be very exciting for both the youth and the kids. So before we go to our service, I just would like to read a portion of scripture for you from the book of Proverbs, chapter 28, verse 13. He who conceals his sins does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them find mercy. So as we approach God's throne this morning as a church, we want to examine ourselves and repent and put ourselves right with God, because when we approach a holy God, we know that we have not worthy, and we need to approach him with a repentant and a penitent heart. So let me lead us in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. Thank you for the work that he did on the cross for our salvation. And let us give thanks with Paul, as he says in Galatians, I have been crucified with Christ, and I live. Not that I live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Lord, help us to realize that we didn't earn our salvation through good works. We didn't earn our salvation in any other way because we are worthy of it. It was a gracious gift from you, Lord. And help us to always remember that and come and approach you with a broken and a contrite heart. a broken and a contrite heart you will not despise, O Lord, as the psalmist says. So we commit our service into your hands, Lord. We very specially commit Steve today as he brings God's word to us. Lord, we pray that you will speak to us through him, and we will be able to apply that message in our lives of loving one another. We also pray for all those who are going to pray, who are going to sing for us, who are going to read the word for us, and also the tech arrangements, Lord, that everything will move smoothly today, Lord. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. And now we will move on to our first song. This is Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Good morning, kids. I hope you've had a good week as we've been able to do more things, and hope you got to see some friends this week as well. Last week, we started learning from a book in the Bible called Mark. It's in the New Testament. There was a man who lived in the desert and may have seemed a bit weird to us. He was telling people an important message from God. Do you remember his name or what his special message was? Yell it out at home if you do. Oh yeah, that's right. His name was John, and he was telling everyone who went to the desert to listen to him to turn back to God so they would be ready for someone even better to come. Someone who would baptize, not with water like John did, but with God's own spirit. For the first time, people just like you and just like me were hearing they could have God's spirit with them. That's a pretty big deal, right? So our story today picks up here with John telling people to turn back to God and helping them get ready for the one who will come to forgive their sin. Let's watch this next part together.
About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. As soon as Jesus came out of the water, he saw the sky open and the Holy Spirit coming down to him like a dove. A voice from heaven said, "You are my own dear son, and I am pleased with you." Straight away, God's Spirit made Jesus go into the desert. He stayed there for 40 days while Satan tested him. Jesus was with the wild animals, but angels took care of him. After John was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee and spread the good news that comes from God. He said, "The time has come. God's kingdom will soon be here. Turn back to God and believe the good news."
So the special guy who came to save people, what was his name? Oh yeah, that's right. His name was Jesus. So Jesus, who was no regular person, came to be baptized by John, the guy who ate bugs. And then, as soon as Jesus came out of the water, God's Spirit came like a dove, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my son." Then straight away, God sent him out to the wilderness to be tempted by Satan. This is a big turn of events, and it all seemed to happen so fast. First, there's the amazing moment of God's presence, the sky being torn open, and literally hearing God say, "I'm pleased with you." And then Jesus was sent to the middle of nowhere for over a month, with no food, no spare clothes, and he was tempted and living around scary wild animals. Have you ever wondered, what is God doing with these two events? I mean, they seem like a big deal, but it also feels a bit confusing. I think God was helping people see Jesus really was the man they had all been waiting for. But he was also showing them that Jesus wasn't just a man. He was Emmanuel, God with us. God showed that when he tore open the sky and sent his spirit on Jesus like a dove. No one else received God's spirit like that. But Jesus was also really a man. He got hungry, he got tired, and was even tempted to do wrong things. God shows us that when he sent Jesus to the wilderness for 40 days. Jesus knew what it was like to have hurts and to be scared and to have things he wanted. And that is why Jesus is our perfect Savior. He had no sin or mess ups of his own to pay for, so he could take all of our sin, but also because he was human and he could understand us. Hebrews 4:15 sums it up pretty well. It says, "Jesus understands every weakness of ours, because he was tempted in every way that we are, but he did not sin." How cool is that? We have a friend in Jesus who knows how hard it is to say no to sin and wrong things. He knows what it's like to be angry, to be afraid, to have a cut, or to want something really bad. And in Jesus, we have a strong Savior who defeats the enemy and rescues us from our weakness. This is what God was doing with these two events. He was showing us and the whole world that this man, Jesus, was fully God and fully human, and he is the only one who can save us from the power of sin and death. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for sending your son Jesus to live a perfect life that we could never live, so that he could take our place and pay for all of our sin and all of our wrong, so that we can have a friendship with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now we are going to move into the home of Lyndall and John, and we are going to, they're going to read, they're going to pray for the church. But before that, I'm going to ask them a few questions about how they have been going with the easing of the restrictions and about the reopening of the church on the 31st of October. So, John and Lyndall, how has the last week been for you, particularly with the easing of the restrictions in New South Wales?
One of the best things for us has been that we've been able to see our grandkids again.
Wow.
So they came down and had a sleepover, which was just wonderful. We had a fantastic time together. That was lovely.
That's good. That's good to hear that. So, John, what do you feel about reopening the church and meeting in person on the 31st of October?
Well, I'm pretty excited, Edwin, but also cautious. We haven't met or won't be met for 16 weeks, and we've got some pretty important things to remember as we regather. So that's why I'm a little cautious.
So now I know a lot of people have been planning and working hard to make this reopening happen well on the 31st of October. Have you and Lyndall been working on anything in particular towards this?
Yeah, Lyndall and I have been working particularly on the welcoming and morning tea, and we're planning firstly to warmly welcome everybody back to church and make sure that church is a safe COVID place. As I've reflected on how we're doing that, I've remembered that there's some essentials that we've grown used to with COVID over the past year and a half, like hand sanitising, wearing masks, physical distancing, and if somebody in your home has symptoms of COVID, getting a test done and staying at home as need be. And if you are having to stay at home, we encourage you to join us online for our services.
All right. So now, John, could you tell us how it'll look like when people turn up on the 31st of October to our church?
Well, the first thing you'll notice is our parking guys out there in their bright yellow vests welcoming people. And then we'll be ushering people from their cars to multiple tables or points where you can have COVID, check in with the COVID code. I guess we're all getting used to that with places like Coles and other shops. Then sanitise your hands, and we'll also make sure that everyone has masks on. We will have spares available. Then someone will usher you from that point to the welcome table where we'll print your name tag and remind you about the importance of not mingling or of physical distancing. After you've checked in at the welcome table, we'd love everyone to move into church and find a family, couple or individual seating group, leaving gaps between the household groups. Moving in like this will reduce the mingling, and we just love to mingle, don't we? At the end of the service, we'll move out of church and go to morning tea.
So, Lyndall, how will morning tea look like when we turn up on the 31st of October?
Well, You're speaking or I speaking?
You're speaking because you're talking about morning tea.
All right. When we come out into the main hall area from the church, one of the things you'll notice is that we'll have as many of the doors open as possible to allow lots of ventilation throughout. Coming out of that hallway from church, on the left-hand side, we will have the children's morning tea outside where it has been in the past, near the play area. The barista coffee will have people lining up, much as when you go to a coffee shop, and they'll be socially distanced and people will take your order. And then after you've placed your order, again, we'll ask people to move outside and somebody will bring your coffee to you when it's been made, so that we're not having to hang around. Now, if you're a person who likes tea or the other sort of coffee or iced water, our table is going to be somewhere slightly different, possibly outside near the entrance, so people can come past there and get their tea or coffee. We'd ask people when they're having their drink that they either sit down on the tables that will be provided inside or at the tables inside or stand outside. We're obviously trying to avoid mingling and getting too, you know, so make sure we're socially distanced.
And all our servers will have masks.
Oh, thank you. All our servers will have, they'll be all double vaccinated. They'll have masks and gloves, and we'll use tongs, and we'll have prepackaged biscuits, just to make sure we're completely safe.
Thank you, Lyndall. You've put a lot of thought into it to sort of have the morning tea outside the church with all the COVID precautions. That's very good. But John, there have been a lot of discussion about ventilation in the enclosed spaces. Now, would you be able to tell us how ventilation will be like in the main auditorium of the church, where more than 100 people will be gathering, I hope, on the 31st of October, and how things will look like in the hub outside?
Well, Edwin, we've been in touch with our architect and mechanical engineers to confirm that our heating, cooling and ventilation system works. And we're pleased to say that we have a very good ventilation system at the church. And the church space where we meet for church is designed to be ventilated by the system. We won't need to open the doors, the external doors. And the system in there and in the hub changes the air and makes sure that there's good fresh air for the maximum number of people in the space. And when it comes to the hub, it'll be the same there. Kids Church will be able to keep the doors closed to reduce the noise with the ventilation on. And as Lyndall said, we're planning to open all the external doors to the hub after Kids Church to enable people to move outside or, if need be, take a seat in the COVID space tables, not on, and chairs in the hub. Now, there will be several other things I'm sure we'll need to communicate over the coming weeks, which we'll do via Steve's email. And there are some specific things we'll need to talk with the 8 a.m. and 5 p.m. welcomers and food teams. But more of that in the coming week. We're really looking forward, Edwin, to gathering as God's people again. And yes, some of us may be a little nervous about church again, but won't it be good to see one another's faces, our smiling faces, and to gather around God's word again.
Thank you so much, John and Lyndall, for enlightening us about what arrangements have been made by the church administrators to reopen the church in a COVID-safe way. And it gives us additional comfort that we have reached 80% vaccination rate. So now, may I ask you both to lead us in prayer?
Thank you. Let's pray. Dear loving Father, we praise you for who you are, the one who created the world and everything in it. We thank you that you love us despite our failings and you want us to be your children. We thank you that you provide us with everything we need. Especially at this time, we thank you for the provision of medical care, for science that develops vaccines to protect us from all sorts of diseases, and for technology that enables us to keep in contact even when we can't personally see each other. Thank you for those in our church who put so much time into enabling our services online each week. and for the hours that have been spent making this work so seamlessly. We're especially thankful that the government is allowing us to meet again in our church building soon. We pray for our return to gathering together, that we might all be sensitive to the concerns of others and thoughtful in our actions as we return to weekly meeting in the church building. Help us to continue to love and care for each other, whether we're here in person or at home watching on live stream. Help us to be Jesus in everything we do, speaking to our friends, our neighbours, encouraging others, and going back to work. Today we pray especially for the families of children who will be returning to school in the next week. We pray that you will especially protect the younger children who have not been vaccinated. Help them to enjoy their learning environment at school and being with their friends there, while continuing to be sensible in their hygiene practices. Lockdown has presented many new challenges for parents and carers doing homeschooling, given us all a new appreciation for teachers and the caring role of schools. Thank you for sustaining families throughout this time of studying at home, and we pray that the students will quickly resume their positive classroom habits and learning. We also thank you for our life groups, for the learning and fellowship that we enjoy as we study your word together and grow more like Jesus as we learn. Thank you for the leaders who put so much time and energy into preparing each time we meet. And thank you for the encouragement that these groups can be, a safe place to share our life together, carry one another's burdens, and to pray with and for one another.
And Heavenly Father, as your word reminds us, we pray for our leaders, particularly bringing our Prime Minister Scott Morrison and Premier Dominic Perrottet before you. As men who profess faith, please help them to seek your guidance in all things. Give them great patience and wisdom as they seek to ease lockdown restrictions and bring a new normal to life in our country. And we also thank you again for those who serve alongside our elected leaders who have particular skills and experience in medicine and science to advise them. And again, we thank you that we'll soon gather here again at Stanhope. Father, this morning we bring our state parliament before you as they consider a new voluntary assisted dying bill. We thank you for the gift of life and pray that all people may be seen as precious in your sight. Help those who are considering this bill to consider how best to care for those who are suffering and in the end stages of life. We thank you for all those who provide palliative care, and wherever appropriate, please increase funding for this care and bring into the lives of those who are suffering people of hope and compassion. We pray this morning for the staff team here at Stanhope, for Steve and Edwin, Rachel, David, Kathy, and our student minister, James. Give them wisdom in the decisions they make about the shape of the ministry of the parish. Enable them to lead with love and compassion, tenderness, vision, and grace. We pray for James, Ali, and Eden as James continues to study at Moore College. Thank you for sustaining them through this challenging year and for surrounding them with other like-minded, gospel-focused people at college. And as Parish Council meets tomorrow night, please enable Steve and Adam, Jeff, John, Kat, Megan, George, Camillo, and David to prayerfully seek your will in all matters that relate to ministry and property and finance, particularly as they consider plans for 2020. May all their deliberations bring great glory to you. And as we come to hear your word read this morning by Russ and Anna and explained by Steve, help us to listen well and respond in obedience and faith. May your powerful, illuminating spirit give us such understanding of what we hear today that we become more like your Son, the Lord Jesus. And it's in his name that we pray all these things. Amen.
Thank you, John Lindell, for participating with us this morning and for your prayers. And we will see you sometime shortly in person.
Bye.
Now we are going to the home of Russell and Anna. And Imogen is there as well, I think. They're going to sort of read the word of God for us before Steve comes to preach the word to us this morning. And I want to ask them a few questions as well. The first question is, how has been the past week for you with the relaxed restrictions and relaxed things about the lockdown, and how have you been going with that last week, Russell and Anna?
Hey, thanks, Edwin. Hello all. Yeah, it's actually been really good. We made full use of our new freedoms. Anna's parents were able to visit last Tuesday. Went and saw a movie on Friday night, and we even went up to the Blue Mountains yesterday. So, taking full advantage and really, really enjoying it. Yeah.
That's right. That's nice to hear. And how do you feel about regathering on the 31st of October?
Yeah, we're excited to, you know, meet back in person. It'll be great to see everybody again. And also looking forward to kids going back to youth and kids' church and seeing kids again and just be able to enjoy their company too. So, yeah, it's what we're looking forward to. Oh,
thank you. So now I know that both you guys were at the book review, Sam's Chance book review of How to Talk About Jesus Without Being That Guy. You've been faithfully participating in the 4 weeks. Now, could you just tell us one or two things that stood out for you that you benefited from that book review?
Sure. Well, it was really good to discuss the book along with our, you know, fellow congregation members. It was really interesting way to do it. And it was a really great book on evangelism. It just made things less scary and more simple. So, like, two of the biggest takeaways I got is just to spend time with people who maybe don't know Jesus, and to listen to them. It even gave you tips on how to listen effectively. And just to getting to know people, it'll help you in sharing your life with them. So that was a really big one for me.
I really enjoyed I guess you realize that it's sort of a relationship, so it's getting to go to other people's things and then they're willing to come to your things. It was, it's more opportunities that way as well. So, it's really good.
Oh, that's lovely. There are going to be opportunities for us to put them in practice. So we'll be talking about that soon, and I'll be writing to you all soon about that. Now, would you please lead us in reading God's word before Steve comes to preach the word for us?
Sure. We're going to be reading from Romans 13, verses 8 to 14. So, Romans 13, 8 to 14. Let no debt remain outstanding, except continuing debt to love one another. For he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. The commandments: do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet. And whatever other commandment there may be are summed up in this one rule: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to its neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let's put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently, as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Thank you,
Russell and Anna, for reading the Word of God for us this morning and sharing your thoughts with us. We will catch you in person sometime soon.
Bye-bye. See you soon. Bye.
See you. Thanks.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to see you. I can't see you. Great to be here together. back in August, we started with 7 chain letters. We sent them out. 2 have been returned. So this red one was by far the quickest. So in 7 times in just over 2 weeks, messages of encouragement and hope sent to one another. And then this pink one also more recently returned. And this pink one went to people from all 3 congregations. So that does mean there are still 5 of them out there. There's the blue one, the yellow one, the green one, the orange one. So maybe if you have one of those, maybe now just send it back in to me or to the church, and you can do that. You can send it to our PO Box, PO Box 234, Stanhope Gardens 2768. So that'll be great. So if you've got one, encourage you to send it back in. Now, we're in the letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the believers in Rome all those years ago. And so when you think about it, it's quite amazing, isn't it, that we still have this letter. We have it today and we can read it, which is just fantastic. So this is God's Word. And in it today, we're going to see God's roadmap for the world. So in New South Wales, we have our roadmap, which keeps on changing. But here is God's roadmap for all the world, and it is the same today as here, given all those years ago. So it gives us a bigger perspective than just what happens at 70% and 80%. This gives us clear direction for life, not just coming out of lockdown, but for everyday life, every day. Now, this could be just the reset you need coming out of lockdown to put things into perspective. Or if you wouldn't call yourself a Christian yet, this could help move you a step closer as you see what it means to be a Christian. Now, last week, we saw our responsibilities to the state, to governing authorities. Today, we see our responsibilities to everyone. So having spoken about paying taxes, the Apostle Paul, he also said to give everyone what you owe them. So we saw that last week. Notice that in verse 7, that it's not just monetary or items that you might have borrowed, but respect and honour. Whatever we owe, if we have a debt, we should pay that back. But there is one thing that we owe that never goes away. It's not your mortgage. Might feel like that at times, but one day I guess that will go away. No, there is one thing that Paul speaks about that we owe everyone that never goes away. And that is to love one another, to love others. Now, you might expect it to be to love God, that's the thing that we owe God. But Paul here doesn't say that. He says the debt that we owe to everyone is to love one another. So you can see that in verse 8, where it says there, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. So our responsibility to every person is to give love. Give love, that is the one big responsibility that we have to everyone. And I don't think it is just to one another in church, but it's to everyone. You might recall when Jesus spoke of the Good Samaritan, the neighbour there was someone not known. Here in Romans 13, the context is the Roman Empire, and so believers are being called here to give love to everyone, whoever their neighbour might be. So it's not just those who are closest to us, although absolutely must be those closest to us. So whether that be your spouse or your children or parents, your friends, our church community, or your work colleagues, we are to give love. Verse 10 tells us something about love, and it says love does no harm, it does no wrong. So we are not to do wrong to or by another person. So whether that be in the home or outside the home, we are to do no harm, no wrong. So if this is how we are to speak and act towards those who we mightn't even know, how much more those that we do? How much more those in our home? The words you speak are to be words that build and encourage, not do harm. To build up, not bring down. Our homes are to be safe places, not places of fear. Our homes are to be places where we give love. If that is your home, then praise God, and I encourage you to keep at it. But if that is not your experience, then I pray that would change. I pray for the homes of our church, that they would be safe places, which starts with each one of us in how we speak and in what we do. It tells us a little bit more about what love is. Back in Romans 12, so you might like to flip there, in verses 9 to 14, it tells us more of what love is. So hear these words or follow on, Romans 12 from verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. We're looking at Romans 13. I want us now to see two reasons why we are to give love, and then we're going to consider what this looks like as we regather. So the first reason to give love is because of the law. God's law. What we looked at last week, that was the law of the land. Here is God's law. When God's commands were given all those years ago and back for us in the Old Testament, it was his law for the land and how life would be good as they came into the promised land. See what he says about the law just here. In verse 8, it says, whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. In verse 9, it says there, speaking of the commandments, it says they are summed up in the one command, to love your neighbor as yourself. And in verse 10, it says love is the fulfillment of the law. What are we called to as Christians? It's really, really two things, isn't it? We are to love God and we are to love others. Jesus said when he was asked what was the most important commandment, he quoted from Deuteronomy 6:4, which says this, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." Now, that's what Jesus said. So if God is our creator, if he is the one who gives us life, gives us our very breath, he gives us this world to live in, we are to love him. He has made us to know him, to love him, to worship him. So we are to give love to the Lord God. But Jesus went on and he said, this is the second greatest commandment. Then he quoted from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, love your neighbor as yourself. So we need to love, we need to do good to those around us. Not doing just what is going to be best for us, but we are to seek the good of those who are around us. We are to care for one another. And so as we give love, we fulfill the law because this is what the law points to, love. Law is summed up in love. Now this isn't new to us, is it? Like being told to love is not new. I don't think for anyone who is listening right now. So why does Paul say this? Well, what it highlights for me is just how important this is. This is our responsibility. We have this one responsibility that Paul says here never goes away. And that responsibility is to give love. Every day is a day to give love. So it must start in the home, but it must leave the home as well. It must mark us as people here at church. It should mark you in your work as well. Wherever we are, we are called to love not ourselves but others. This is such a big part of what it is to live as a Christian, as we know God's love for us, that amazing love, the amazing grace that we sang about earlier. We, having experienced that, not only at the cross, but every day, God's love to us, we are to give love to others. So that is the first reason here, seeing for us to give love. This is what God asks of us. Well, the second reason is because of the time. Verse 11. Speaks of, it says, and do this. The do there, it's not actually there. It's been added in, so this it helps to read a bit clearer. So it says, and this, and do this, understanding the present time. What is the present time? Not 10 to 11 or whatever it is. This is where we go big. And this is God's understanding of time. And so this is much bigger than just coming out of lockdown time. This looks at time in the big sense of time. You might remember just a few weeks ago when we were in Romans 8, Edwin and Phil spoke there about living in the now but not yet. There's suffering now, but there's glory to come. We have been redeemed, but we also wait for our redemption to be fully realized. We have been adopted into God's family, yet we still wait for that adoption to be fully realized. It is the overlap of the ages. So there's this little picture is going to come up for you to see. I got the present age, but you got the age to come. And we live now in the overlap, in that in-between, between Christ's resurrection and his return, the overlap of the ages. Paul goes on and he uses imagery of night and day, darkness and light, as he talks about this time that we live in. So have a look or listen from verse 11. I'm going to read through to verse 14. And do this understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy,
Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. Now is the time. Now is the time to give love. Or you could say from these verses, now is the time to live in the light. For that is who we are. If you are a Christian, you are a person. We are a people of Christ, of the light. And the two are related, giving love and living in the light. So the deeds of darkness that we just saw here, they're all selfish activities, aren't they? They're all about satisfying yourself, self-gratification. They really are not about the other person. When we have clarity on the age to come, and that in Christ, that is where we belong, then that is what we will give ourselves to. And yes, it will be a battle. Yes, we will need to be intentional. And so Paul speaks here of putting on the armor of light and clothing ourselves with Christ. Getting up each day and, I don't know, whatever you've dressed yourself in today, Paul speaks here of clothing yourself with Christ and doing that every day. Clothe yourselves with Christ. When we have this clarity of the time and who we are, where we belong, that our identity is in Christ, and that we are deliberate about it, then rather than giving ourselves and thinking about ourselves and gratifying the desires of the flesh, we will instead more and more give love. If we are clothed with Christ, and if our mind is renewed more and more by Christ, we will be able to, some extent, give the love of Christ to whoever is before us and around us. So these verses give us a perspective, and they help us see our identity. And so I think those two things are really key here. A little example. So Dom is now our premier. His time is now. He is till the next election, or if he's then given another term, he is to wake up each day and serve this state. All right, that is his responsibility, and now is his time. Here, the Apostle Paul, he is calling us to wake up and understand the time. Our salvation, the age to come, it is nearer now than when we first believed. All right, it is nearer today than it was yesterday. And so he's calling us to wake up each day and to clothe ourselves with Christ, with his life and his righteousness that Christ has given us. And as we do that, we are to give ourselves to giving love and living in the light. As you raise your family, do so by giving love and living in the light. As you go to school, to work, to sport, whatever it is that you might be doing, do so by giving love and living in the light. As you enjoy your days after paid work, retirement, do so by giving love and living in the light. Every day is a day to give love. Every day is a day to live in the light. And if you are not yet a believer, I invite you to keep coming, keep finding out more about Jesus. And I invite you to take that step towards Christ, to join us in the light and for the age to come. Will you do that? Join us in loving God and in loving others, all in response to God's love of us, Christ's love for us. That is the best thing that you could do coming out of lockdown. So maybe today, take action. Tell us that you would like to find out more, that you want to join Christ. And you can tell us on the Connect card. You can let us know there if you are would like to find out more, to ask a question. Well, continuing on, Romans 14 and 15, they look at loving one another when we mightn't agree with each other. And so we're going to explore that over the next couple of weeks to practically see, well, just how do we love one another, especially when we don't agree with each other. So that's the next few weeks. But now, as we regather in 2 weeks' time, let us do so with an attitude of love and to give love. Let us work really hard when we arrive, when we walk through those front doors at church, to do so with an attitude of giving love. Now, we might not know who is and who is not vaccinated. But we do know that the vaccination rates are very high, so we can praise God. And they're going to be even higher in another 2 weeks. I think Canberra, the rate we're going, Canberra and Sydney are on track to be the most vaccinated cities in the world. The ACT, I think they're on track to even break 100% for the first dose. Our local rates, they're higher than the state rate. So as we come and regather, we can do so with great confidence and reassurance that just about everyone around us in our community has been vaccinated. But also, there might be some who are not, and that might be you. And in some sense, it's really no different when we go to the shops, go to Coles. You don't know who is and who is not. When we regather, everyone is welcome. Although we are saying that at 8 a.m., that will be only for those who are vaccinated. We want everyone to be comfortable, to come to a service. And so we hope by giving that option, we hope that that is loving to you. Our expectation is that anyone who is volunteering in any way will be vaxxed. By saying that, again, we're trying to be loving to everyone who comes. But also, we want to be loving in how we say that to you who serve. Now, some might choose to remain with church at home to start out with, and that's okay if that's what you decide to do. We want to love and respect you in that. Those who do so might do so out of love for others because they're not yet double vaccinated. Or they might do it for personal reasons, for health reasons, for work reasons. You might not know why, and we don't need to know why. We just need to love and respect everyone. All right? That's what we need to do. Some might opt to go to 5 p.m. Instead of 10 a.m. To free up more space at 10 and to be part of a service at 5 that isn't quite as big than it is at 10. There's still kids' church at 5, and although we don't have morning tea there, sorry about that, we do have food, and we're planning a dinner the second Sunday back. We're going to have a dinner outside together, so we're looking forward to that. So as we come, wearing a mask, doing the things that John and Lyndall spoke about, so sitting down to drink your coffee or taking it outside, to stand and talk with people, whatever it is, it's all part of loving one another, respecting one another's space, doing the right thing, not just by the governing authorities that we saw last week, but also doing the right thing by one another. And Hope Youth, not long before you're back, Thursday week, so you can have this same attitude. As you come, as you walk through the doors, to give love, to be thinking about the others that you're meeting with. And as those in Year 6, as they come and join with you, you can welcome them That would be the most loving thing to do. Now, I know we're going to do this, especially if we intentionally walk through those front doors with that attitude of giving love to each person around us, thinking not primarily of ourselves, but of others. So how good for all of us, if every single person is thinking about others, then that is a church that we'll want to belong to, and that's a church that we'll want to invite others to. So looking forward to be able to regather and to keep expressing our love, not only to God, but to one another. Let's pray. Our loving Father, we do praise you for your amazing love to us. And yeah, we really have a debt to love you, but that is not what is spoken about here. The debt here is that we love one another. Father, may we do so because we know your love, because of the love of Christ to us. May we be a people of love. So more and more keep changing us, keep shaping us into the people that you want us to be. And Father, help us to give love and help us to live in the light, all to your praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to sing, so I invite you to join in. And you might like to share also with those who are at home with you or on the chat, share maybe one thing that has stood out to you this morning.
Days that God has numbered, I was made to walk with him. Yet I look for worldly treasure and forsake the King of Kings. But mine is hope in my Redeemer. Though I fall, his love is sure. For Christ has paid for every failing, I am his forevermore. Mine are tears in times of sorrow, darkness not yet understood. Through the valley I must travel, where I see no earthly good. But mine is peace that flows from heaven, and the strength in times of need. I know my pain will not be wasted, Christ completes his work in me. Mine are days here as a stranger, pilgrim on the narrow way. One with Christ I will encounter, harm and hatred for his name. But mine is armor for this battle, strong enough to last the war. And he has said he will deliver safely to the golden shore. And mine are keys to Zion City, where beside the King I walk. For there my heart has found its treasure, Christ is mine forever. Come rejoice now, O my soul, For his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul. For his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul. For his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. Christ is mine forevermore. And mine are keys to Zion City, where beside the King I walk. For there my heart has found its treasure. Christ is mine forevermore.
Thank you so much, guys, for putting those songs together. I know they really mean a lot to me. It's just beautiful. So thanks for doing that and spending time to do that for us. Also, thanks, Steve, for bringing the word. I found it really encouraging and just enlightening as well. What about you, Edwin? What did you find encouraging?
Yeah, I found it very encouraging because the first time I looked at verse 8 of chapter 13 and understood it in the proper context, it says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. I thought this continuing debt was only for the church, for among Christians, but Steve explained that it was in the context of the Roman Empire who was oppressing the Christians, and Paul here clearly says it's for the he who loves his fellow man and not just Christians. So that was a big eye-opener to me, that we had to continue to love others, even our enemies. That's the debt that we always owe to others.
Mm. Yeah, wow, that's awesome. Mm. Thanks.
How about you, Rachel? Did you find anything interesting?
Yeah, I think what helped me the most was seeing that God's word is what gives us perspective on the time that we live in. So, and I think sometimes we wonder how on earth are we going to love people like this, because it's really hard, like we don't always want to. And I think seeing the time that we live in as God does is one of the driving factors that will help us see people how God does and to pursue them in love as he does, because he knows the time is short and he knows he wants them with him in heaven. So yeah, that was helpful for me.
Mm. Thank you. That's right. So what have you got planned for next week, Rachel?
Yeah, so next week, I just wanted to let you guys know, we'll have our Zoom for the years 1 to 4 with Jim and myself. But sadly, we won't be able to have the year 5-6 Zoom. So I just wanted to go ahead and let you guys know, no Zoom for 5-6, but we will meet with years 1 to 4.
Lovely. So that brings us to the close of our morning service, yeah. Isn't it? So we are looking forward to seeing many of you on the 31st of October in person. But till then, stay safe and God bless you.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Have a good week.